I'll bet you've heard a lot of advice about informational interviews, and you may have done several of them. In this video, I'll tell you some things you don't want to do that you may have not heard before. In more than 20 years in industry, I've learned a lot about informational interviews from being on both sides several times. The things that really stick out in my head are when somebody screwed it up. So I want to give you four common mistakes, things that I've seen people do wrong in informational interviews. And if you stick around to the end, I'll tell you one important thing you need to make sure you do right. Hey everybody, Dave Giltner with TurningScience. Informational interviews are a great way to learn about a field you'd like to go work in. You've probably gotten a fair amount of advice about how to do these. One place is career centers often have these flyers that they hand out, and these can be really helpful. They tend to be sort of a recipe-driven approach to how you might do an informational interview. The thing is, the people that write these up tend to make a career out of working in a career center, and they usually have not spent much time, if any, out in the private sector seeing how informational interviews actually get done and how people tend to screw them up. Well, I have, so in this video, I want to give you four big mistakes I've seen when people try to do informational interviews. The first mistake, don't go into them expecting to get a job. Informational interviews are about learning more about an industry or a field that you might be interested in working in, or learning more about a company that you think you might like to work for. But if you go into it with the expectation of getting a job, you're going to get frustrated quickly, and you're not going to make the kind of progress that you really ought to. Now, I thought this was fairly obvious, but I saw another informational video recently that was describing informational interviews as something you do around an open position, one that you see posted. That's a pretty narrow view of what informational interviews are. It sounds great. You see an opening, you call them up and say, hey, can I do an informational interview? But that's essentially forcing your way into a job interview. Sounds great, but good luck with that. Informational interviews are actually much broader than that. They don't only relate to open positions, because frankly, most good positions don't even get posted. Informational interviews are about you taking control of your career and learning more about a field or a technology that you find interesting, or a company you think you might like to work for. I have a five-step process for how you design a career in the private sector. And the third step is build your network, and informational interviews are an important part of that. So when you're doing informational interviews, start your search not around job openings, but around things you want to learn more about. Technologies that you find interesting, markets or applications you want to learn more about, companies that you're impressed by or you think somebody someday you'd like to work for. You want to be able to approach people saying, I'm interested in learning more about this. Something your company does, or perhaps how people build careers in this area. Make it your own initiative and something you want to learn about. If you go into it looking for a job, that's just the wrong approach. It's too limiting and you will get frustrated. Now, certainly if you impress people during your informational interviews, and if down the road one of these companies has an opening, chances are they will contact you if they think you might be a good fit. So it could result in a job, but you certainly don't want to go into it expecting that. It's limiting and you'll just get frustrated. Mistake number two, don't skip the research. Before you go into an informational interview, make sure that you've researched the company and what they do. Look into the technology that they work with, the markets they serve, the products that they sell. It's all a really important part because although you're going there to learn things, to learn more about something you want more information about, it's important to impress them as well. You never know who they might be able to refer you to. And of course, if down the road they have an opening, you want them to come back to you. So you'll get bonus points if you've read something about a recent press release or a news item, or you know something about a recent success of the company. All these things will help you. So that research is important. Now, if this seems like hard work, it is. That's why it's important that you narrow your search and target only one or two areas. Because that way, you can do the deep research to really understand the technology, or the market, or the products, or the company, and you can express to them why you're interested in it, why you think it would be a good fit for you, why you think it fits your strengths. But also, it helps them feel better about the time they are spending with you. When you've done your research, it shows you've taken initiative, that you've really done your homework, and you know why you were designing the career that you were designing. You know why you're there talking to them. Everybody likes to help somebody who shows initiative and does hard work to build something for themselves. Mistake number three, don't talk only about yourself. Now, this is a risk for people who go in expecting to get a job or hoping to get a job. They want to make sure the interviewer hears enough about them so that they're impressed and they remember them. Not a good idea. You are there to learn more about them, to learn about the company they work for, learn about what they do in their job, learn about maybe the career path and how they got to where they are. So make sure you ask genuine questions about what they do, what they find challenging in their jobs, what they find exciting about their jobs. Make sure you listen more than you talk. Now, if you have trouble finding questions that you genuinely want to ask, that you're genuinely interested in, maybe you're not targeting the right area. This is why it's important to narrow your search to things you're truly excited about. If you're truly excited about a technology or an industry or a company, you will find things from your research that you want to ask about, and the conversation will flow normally. And of course, if it's been a good conversation, you've asked a lot about them, they will naturally ask about you, so you will get a chance. But don't force it. Like any human relationship, pacing is important, and you need to give that time. Don't talk only about yourself. Mistake number 4, don't expect people to want to talk to you. Now, I'm not saying they won't want to talk to you. I'm just saying it's not the top of their list of things to do for the week. I hear a lot of advice about informational interviews that make it sound like there's people out in industry waiting for people to contact them to do informational interviews. The fact is, they don't. People are busy. I don't know a single person in industry who sits at their desk thinking, gee, I sure wish a graduate student would contact me for an informational interview so I don't have to do my regular work. That just doesn't happen. And if you find somebody sitting at their desk with nothing better to do, that's not the person you want to be interviewing anyway. Now, that doesn't mean people won't want to talk to you, but it does mean you have to be creative and help them see that it's going to be worth their time. You want to be respectful of their time. You want to come across as professional and competent. You want to have done your research so that you know what you're talking about. Look, if somebody approaches me and they know what they want to do, they'd like to be part of my industry, they've done their homework, they know where they're headed, I'm happy to help them. I'd like to help them take a step forward. I'd like to be part of helping them in their career. But if they come in unprepared, they don't seem professional, they don't really know what they want to do, look, I got better things to do, and I don't want to spend the time to talk to them. Okay, so those are the 4 big informational interview mistakes that I wanted to talk about today. But at the beginning of the video, I also told you I would tell you the one important thing you always need to do, and that is to show proper etiquette. So when I talk about this, I have a very specific example in mind. It's something that happened to me recently. So I'll tell you about it because it's got a couple of etiquette problems in it. So a couple of guys who were physics graduate students had contacted me, because that's my discipline, and they were considering starting a company in photonics technology space. That's where I've made my career. I've been there for the last 20 years, and they wanted to ask me some questions. And in fact, they'd been referred to me by another longtime contact. So there you go. That's the power of networking. We had arranged to meet at a coffee shop, and they wanted to ask me some questions, essentially an informational interview about starting a company. So I arrived at the coffee shop on time, and after sitting there for about 5 or 10 minutes, I went ahead and got my own coffee, bought my own coffee. Finally, about 15 minutes later, one of the two guys showed up and said, my colleague can't make it, it's just gonna be me today. He sat right down at the table, didn't offer to buy me a scone or something else to drink. He didn't even get his own coffee. So I guess if I hadn't bought my own, we would have sat there in the coffee shop for 45 minutes without buying anything. And that made a strong impression on me. It wasn't respectful to me. It wasn't respectful to the coffee shop. It showed a lack of savvy that certainly doesn't bode well for his entrepreneurial aspirations. We had a good conversation. He asked a number of good questions. At the end of it, after about 45 minutes, he got up, said thanks, and he left. Never sent any kind of follow-up note, no thank you or anything like that to touch base. It's been more than 3 months, and I haven't heard from him. So that didn't make a very good impression either. I can tell you, I would not recommend either of these guys to anybody else. They may diss them the same way they dissed me, and I don't want to do that. That would look bad on me if I refer them. I certainly wouldn't want to hire either of them for any kind of a job because of their behavior at this informational interview. So despite not knowing anything about their technical capabilities, the lack of respect, the lack of etiquette they showed turned me off, and I would neither recommend them to a contact or hire them for a job. So my recommendation is always pay attention to etiquette, no matter what you're doing, where you are, because that makes a strong impression. And if you mess that up, you could ruin a lot of chances you might have. So I've given you 4 things you don't want to do in your informational interviews. But if you're coming from academia, if your only experience to date is academic research, you might be wondering, what can I do to sound more experienced to somebody in industry? So when we're having this conversation, I sound like I know what I'm talking about, especially when I talk about my academic experience. Is there something I can do? And this is a great thing to think about. If you're wondering about this, I suggest you check out the video that I've got in the description notes below this video. It's called 5 Plus 1 Ways to Impress an Interviewer. Now, this video is part of our Turning Science Academy program, so we don't have it here on YouTube, but if you click the link and drop your email, you will get it for free. I suggest you check this out. It's just in the description notes below this video. So that's all I have to say about informational interviews today. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, please click the like button below. It'll help me, but more importantly, it'll help other people who can benefit from this video because more likes means YouTube shows it to more people. And if you want to get more of these videos for yourself, click the subscribe button and ring that notification bell. That way you will be the first to get the next one. I post about 2 of these a month to help you design the career you really want. Thanks for watching. Now let's get out there and turn science into things people need.